Doug, as we've been reporting, the violence we saw in Harare, or rather the protests, were in response to the Electoral Commission announcing results for the parliamentary elections. We haven't yet had the results for the presidential election, so really it begs the question, how will people then react after those results are announced?
Right. Look, obviously, I'm not an oracle here, but I think it's a safe bet to say that, you know, given all of these not so latent tensions and the fact there's such deeply embedded distrust, especially the opposition towards the ruling ZANU-PF party and the way it runs its elections, that if it emerges that the right now installed president Emerson Mnangagwa is actually declared the winner, it's hard to imagine a scenario in that there won't be some level of protest among the opposition, with varying scenarios of the intensity of those protests. And by the same token, it's hard to imagine a scenario which a lot of observers say is more remote, but if the opposition candidate Nelson Chamisa were also declared a winner, in which you wouldn't have a very tense situation waiting to see how the military and security forces, who have been historically under the Mugabe era sort of beholden to the ZANU-PF party, how they would react. Would they not be sort of more behind their candidate, so to speak, Mnangagwa? Would they accept the legitimacy of an opposition candidate declared the winner? How would that play out? That said, it's in any candidate's interest, and especially Mnangagwa, because he basically ran on this sort of Zimbabwe being open for business, business-friendly environment. He needs to have international legitimacy. He needs to be seen as a legitimate president with some sort of mandate to fix Zimbabwe's catastrophic state of affairs, which is why we're hearing hints today and explicit statements today from the ZANU-PF leader in Mnangagwa that he's in communication with the opposition, that he wants, that he's calling for an investigation. He wants everything to be done peacefully. He's stressing now, you know, backing away from that brink. He really knows that it's absolutely mandatory, essential, that things proceed peacefully from here. And look, who knows what the nature of that communication is with the opposition leader and his allies. Perhaps offering posts in an eventual government if Mnangagwa is declared the victor, something to sort of placate, to appease the opposition. We've had in the past a unity government, which didn't last too long, but it did at least initially stir hopes in the international community of a more stable, a more peaceful Zimbabwe going forward. So that would be my hunch right now. They're trying to reach some sort of understanding and to try to bridge those very vast differences between the two camps.
You mentioned the economic difficulties, a bit of an understatement for Zimbabwe. But so whoever wins, there are massive challenges ahead.
I mean, look, you know, it's often been said that Zimbabwe has gone from being, you know, one of the region's breadbaskets to its basket case. And it's not an exaggeration. I mean, there's no reason that it shouldn't be a very rich, prosperous country. And we've even heard, you know, some of the party officials in the ruling party say that they think it could, within a few years, have a $100 billion economy with 7% annual growth. Now, that's a far cry from what we're seeing. I just want to bring up a few quick sort of a reality check for our viewers on what the actual situation is. When I say basket case, that's not an exaggeration. Millions, up to about 2.5 million may actually need some sort of food help, food aid from the international community because food prices have soared. The cash crisis mixed with the hyperinflation have led to a situation which the Zimbabwean dollar has not existed for almost a decade. It hasn't existed. The government's instead had to use the U.S. dollar. It helped to stabilize initially the economy. The government's tried to bring back some form of local currency in the form of electronic currency or bond notes. But, you know, consumers aren't fooled by that. They know that it isn't really backed by real liquid, by real hard currency. Inflation remains rampant. People have no purchasing power. And look at that last statistic there. It's absolutely stunning. 6% of the working age population has a formal job in the workforce. That is staggering. And like I said, this coming from an economy that has no reason not to be very prosperous. These are all in the inbox of whoever is declared the next president. Astronomical challenge. They'll need all the help they can get from the international community, the IMF, the World Bank, and the goodwill also of the people inside Zimbabwe.